Kia ora and welcome to the Nishkesh Variety Show. Coming at you with a multitude of Kiwi sporting topics, but we are deep in this Wellington Phoenix playoff push, so we are going to pour a bit of energy into the Wellington Phoenix as they roll into the playoffs with great ease on the back of Clayton Lewis excellence. We have just recorded the warm-up korero prior to the variety show, which is just for our patrons. So if you are a patron of the Nishkesh, thank you very much. There will be that podcast on the Patreon page in a couple of days, so check that out. We talked about, it was pretty much the art of playmaking on the back of some of the skills and talents of Rhys Walsh. We talked a lot about playmaking and also a bit about the Warriors pipelines. Every Monday and Friday, email comes out to our email subscribers. You can sign up via Substack. Links are on our Facebook and Twitter page. There's always a bit of extra content there. I'm starting out the Kiwi NRL power rankings every Monday. And the Wildcard is always serving up extra goodies as well. And of course, we are always writing about Kiwi sports in all its glory at thenish-cash.com. Wobbly Wildcard, can you please open up that baggie of mindfulness and serve us up one?
I absolutely can. Can I just ask first, does the signing of Jared Beale move the needle for the Dragons out of last place on the Kiwi NRL rankings?
No, definitely not. Sorry.
Okay. I suspected that was the answer you were going to give. Anyway, baggie of mindfulness is stacked with Bob Dylan records at the moment because it was the great man's 80th birthday party. Well, birthday party. I'm sure he had a party, but definitely his 80th birthday. I think on Monday it was, but time zones make it weird when you're in New Zealand thinking about days for other people around the world. But because of that, obviously there's been a fair bit of celebration about the fella's life and achievements and various creative exploits, and that's meant plenty of content to absorb across the interwebs. I was actually last night watching, didn't finish it because it's long, but the Martin Scorsese documentary that came out a couple years ago, the Rolling Thunder review, and there was a line that Bob said early on in that, which I thought was really interesting. He said, life isn't about finding yourself or finding anything. Life is about creating yourself and creating things. And I don't entirely agree with that, because I think there's stuff where it's like, there are essential parts of people who, which like we need to sort of find ways to live in harmony and happiness with our like personalities and stuff that we can't change. That's always important. But I do like the idea of throwing it out that there's another way as well. Like it's not one way or the other. It's one way and the other. Different situations call for different aspects of identity, call for different approaches, but definitely the idea that you can just like create your identity is also an important one for a lot of people to think about. Like you can reinvent yourself, you can be a different person in different scenarios and wear different masks or whatever if you want. Like you have that control over who you are and how people perceive you. I think it's an interesting way to think about stuff. I'll repeat the quote again. He said, life isn't about finding yourself or finding anything. Life is about creating yourself and creating things. And Bob Dylan is a guy who, more than almost anyone else in the 20th century, was constantly, and still is to this day, like reinventing himself, finding different ways to present himself and different sounds as a musician and different identities to express to the public. So he's probably a living example of exactly what he's just saying there.
And you create the life you want to create. You create your own destiny.
For sure.
Like all those type of cheesy quotes are about creation, and that's you creating it. So as opposed to like, yeah, you might find it and you might stumble on it or you might go seeking, but it's all semantics. But I think there's a bit more power in creation. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, it's control over your own fate ultimately, isn't it? And the stuff that you discover and find is also ingredients for what you want to create in the future. Like how do I put this in a good example? Like, if you have the paints, you might find like the canvas. You can't change the canvas, but you can add to it. You can paint some pretty flowers in the corner or whatever. You can change a sunny day to a nighttime setting or a moonlit sky or whatever. Like you can do your best Bob Ross impersonations on what you're given. Like you can alter it as well as you can find it and create it at the same time, I suppose I'm saying.
If you can't afford an expensive, like the upgrades for extra toppings on your pizza, you can always buy a cheaper pizza and buy a bit of extra pepperoni and put it on top of the pizza. You know, you can always buy a gourmet ingredient separately at a cheaper price and put it on top of your pizza as well. Correct?
Brilliant metaphor. That's exactly it right there, yeah.
I thought it was a bit of a stretch there. I had to tinker it on the fly. Let's.
Because I've done that specifically myself, like adding to the old, like $5 Food Town pizzas, and chuck some better sauce on them, a little more cheese, a couple, I don't know, chuck some pepperonis, yeah, a bit of gherkin or olives or whatever, yeah, stack it yourself, make it work.
That's a bloody handy hint, I think, for a lot of food purveyors. Let's start the show with our 1332 Radio Sport hot take. I'm going to kind of hijack a hair wildcard and just set us up for a couple Wellington Phoenix yarns here, because they are in the middle of their playoff push in the A-League. We're recording this on Tuesday. I think they play Wednesday night, and they've got this week off to a great start. 3-0 win at the Caketon. Beautiful Wellington Phoenix crowd. Wildcard, in that moment, in that experience of laying down on the couch and watching the Wellington Phoenix play football, I felt the magic of football. I felt the quintessential magic of football that I assume everyone who loves football, they've got their fantasies about being there in England and chanting and singing and the whole experience. And I felt the magic of football, just the way the crowd would kind of narrate what was happening on the field. The flow of the game was reflected in the crowd, and it was, yeah, I can watch like a Dortmund home game with a pre-COVID with jam-packed stadium and all the glitz and the glamour of what the fans do, but it just feels different when it's Wellington, when it is the Wellington Phoenix, when it is that first home game in a long time. The football and the attacking prowess and the dominance of Wellington Phoenix was perfectly matched in marriage, in sacred matrimony, with the magic of the crowd.
The magic of the crowd and sacred matrimony and all that. I like the, we're coming up with some good metaphors on the Today Show. I agree. I like the, I don't know, it was just such a great occasion. And like to the extent where I'll chuck in a vitamin stat later on, which got completely buried. It was the first thing I've like discovered this myself, not realizing I hadn't seen it written anywhere else or, reported on anywhere else. But like, it was Ufuk-Tele's 50th game in charge of the Phoenix. And, as an A-League manager, we're excluding one FFA Cup game because they don't count, but like, so much was happening, and there was just like a big dramatic homecoming, and it was a huge crowd, like the biggest crowd any team has had in an A-League game this season. It was like, it just had that sense of stars aligning, didn't it? Because the Phoenix got the perfect result. Like it wasn't that close of a game. I think they were pretty comfortably the better team and pretty much deserved a 3-0 win as well. It was against Western United as well, so there's that rivalry factor there. And the fact that it was Andrew Durante's final game in Wellington, he's retiring at the end of the season, and he got to have a big send-off in front of a huge crowd. Like, there was so much about that which just, it did feel magical, didn't it? It just felt like, yeah, the stars aligned for something, and I'm just really hoping that flows on into the last three games of the season as well, because the Phoenix could do something special with the momentum they're getting from here, but they have left themselves a lot of work to do in a short space of time. So if there is a sense of destiny that comes from what we had on Saturday afternoon, then hopefully that has a flow-on effect for the rest of the season, basically.
I think part of that magic was the reaction to Andrew Durante as well during the game. the booze of Andrew Durante. Do you... I believe you've got a bit of a hot take about that.
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to throw up, is I not having it. No deal for me on the Andrew Durante booing. Cannot abide it. Will not stand for it. Don't even get the argument. We'll look at, like, I can understand it for someone like Mark Rudin, obviously, because there was a little bit of a deviant way in which he left the team. Obviously some bad blood there as well, and then to come back and scout a couple of, or snatch up a couple of other players as well to bring along with him to Western United, and Durante was one of those. But as much as Durante was playing for the opposition team here, like, so were 10 other people. And I think when you're Andrew Durante, 24 cap all-white as an adopted New Zealander, 281 games for the Phoenix, captaining them throughout, like, someone who did as much as anybody else to legitimize the Phoenix as an A-League entity, I think at his age that he was, and there were some, like, the last couple of his years where there was definitely a decline there as well, so there was also a football decision to be made, like, I think he pretty much pretty comfortably, beyond take out the Kiwi humility aspect of the pretty much there, like, he had definitely gone beyond the point of, like, we can handle him. I think he had the right to, like, do what he wanted in the last couple of years. I don't have any dramas with him going to Western United. Certainly wouldn't ever have thought to, I know it's been a bit of a divisive one amongst Phoenix fans as well, certainly wouldn't have thought to boo him. I know that the case was, like, it's only during the 90 minutes afterwards he definitely got the, you know, the big emotional send-off that he deserved, and the huge applause from the big crowd, and got quite emotional for himself. Was, you know, a few tears there from Jura having to, like, catch himself while he was trying to say thank you and farewell to the fans, where he spent, like, you know, a decade of his career, most of the prime years of his career as well, which, like, is something that you can't take away, and, like, that's another enormous factor of how important he was to this team, like, and how he did legitimize them. I thought the booing was a little bit distasteful, as I have thought on other occasions, but certainly, like, he did get the send off at the end that he deserved for sure.
Let's slide into the vitamin statistic. What is your key, interesting, funny, funky, lovely statistic to do with Wellington Phoenix?
Well, Ufuk Talai's 50th A-League game in charge of the Phoenix. It sort of crept up, and there was so much else to talk about from that game at the Caketon there, that I noticed I didn't say Westpac or Sky on this occasion, that it almost got just forgotten. And considering Uffy had just re-signed as well in the lead-up to that game for a couple more years, like, it's a big deal. He's lasted 50 games. He has, I think, the best winning percentage of any Phoenix manager, actually. I haven't got that amongst my stats because I forgot to look that up. But 20 wins, 12 draws, 18 losses. He's played one of those 50 games, was a finals game as well, which was unfortunately was one of those 18 losses, but so it goes. Regular season, he's got 1.47 points per game, which is pretty solid. That is, like, top six form. Plus 23 goal difference, which is excellent. Celebrated his 50th game, obviously, with a 3-0 win over his predecessor. So that's also on a personal level. Nice, and another one of those stars aligning moments. He was also tied for his biggest ever win as a Phoenix manager. 3-goal margin is something he's only done, he has done on 4 occasions, hasn't gone better at any point. And he did it without Ulysses Davia, who is the player who has played the most for him in those 50 games. 48 of the 50 games that Davi has been involved. This is just the second one that he'd missed. David Ball is second on that list. He's appeared in 47 out of 50 games. The next most after that is a tie between Joshua Soterio and Cameron Devlin, 42 games apiece, and then Tim Payne and Alex Rufer with 40 apiece bring up the, the rest of the top five, but they're tied for fifth, so the top six, I suppose. Uffy done some excellent things, taking the Phoenix from a solid team that he inherited to an even better team in the two seasons henceforth, and he's got them in a state right now where they're only going to have two proper home games all season, and with 3 games left, including one of those home games, they're still in it. You know, they're still competing for a playoff spot, and that's pretty impressive as well. That might be his best achievement of all.
Kia kaha. Ufuk talai. My vitamin statistic this week, I think it's a beauty, and I'm so happy I found it. Roger Tuivasa-Sheck against the Tigers, whole game as a winger. That resulted in Roger Tuivasa-Sheck having the fewest touches of the football that he has had this season. He had 24 touches, and that is the only time this season he has had fewer than 30 touches. He had 30 touches against the Melbourne Storm, which, if I do remember correctly, was when Rhys Walsh made his debut. So he's had less than 35 just twice, less than 30 just once, and West Tigers, he had the fewest amount of touches in a game that he has had this season. Same game, and Roger Tuivasa-Sheck had the most run meters of any game this season. He had 272 run meters. The second highest was round 5 versus the Manly Seagulls when he had 259. So this is the first game all season in which Roger Tuivasa-Sheck has passed 260 run meters, let alone 270. So the move to wing for Roger Tuivasa-Sheck in one game, ginormous sample size there, he had the fewest amount of touches that he has had this season and the most run meters that he has had this season. Hold up, though. Hold up. This was also the only game this season in which Roger Tuivasa-Sheck has had a try assist, and a line break. He had one try assist, and two line breaks versus the Tigers. It is the only game this season in which he has had one of each. He's had a game where he's had two try assists. He's had a game where he's had two line breaks and a try. He's had a game where he's had a try and a try assist. But he has not had a game this season in which he has had at least one of each. It's also the same game he had the most run meters, and it's also the same game that he had the fewest touches. Pretty interesting.
Yeah, less is more, apparently, with Roger Tuivasa-Sheck. I'm going to go for a deep old trip into the mangroves here with a fellow by the name of Kyle Glogowski. And if you don't know who he is, like, it's quite a good time to start learning who he is. He's been a name for me, but someone who I didn't have maybe enough of a deeper appreciation for. He's a baseball pitcher coming out of... he's a Kiwi lad, 22 years old, has played for the Auckland Tuatara, he's played for the Diamondbacks internationally, has been in the Philadelphia Phillies system for a few years since 2018. He played rookie ball, went back in 2019, played A and double, and played A and A plus. 2020 didn't really happen for anyone for obvious reasons, but he's back over there now in 2021. Started off playing double A, very quickly promoted to triple A, where he's played 2 games so far, both as a starting pitcher for the Philadelphia Phillies affiliate there. AAA is like, this is one step below the major leagues. There's never been a New Zealand player to play in Major League Baseball. There's been a couple who have played like solid, Scott Campbell, Travis Wilson, both had solid AAA careers. So Glogowski's not at a... he's not like a unique case yet, but at his age to have moved up the ranks as swiftly as he has, he might, he's the best bet we've had in a very long time to get to the majors. First game in AAA didn't go so well. He gave up 3 earned runs in 2.1 innings, which is actually 2 1/3 innings, because that's how baseball lingo works. It's 2 innings and 1 out, basically. He gave up a home run in that game, wasn't the best, but his second one was a fair bit better. He got through 3 clean innings, took care of the side in the first, one man out, second man out, third man out, no one on base or anything. Did get himself into trouble in the second, where he gave up a couple walks and there was a pass ball, allowed one of those guys to get to third base, and then line drive single coughed up his first run of the game, although it was unearned because of the pass ball. came back with a couple strikeouts afterwards to get out of the innings without doing much damage. His team, the Reading Fighting Phils, which, like, minor league baseball teams are crazy, man. Like, the names that they have is just so weird. Anyway, his team then bagged four runs in the top of the third to take a lead. Glogoski gave up two hits in the third, cost him one run, but all up, three innings, one earned run, three hits, two strikeouts, two walks. 54 pitches, 31 of them strikes. Pretty solid effort. He was mostly in control the whole time, which is awesome. And when he did get out of control, he brought it back with those two strikeouts. So didn't get the win because you got to go four innings as a starting pitcher to be credited with a win. So the first reliever got it. But they're obviously building him up, like 2.1 innings the first time, three innings the second time. Hopefully go a little bit longer the next time, especially after a much more promising second appearance at the mound. So pretty good signs for Glogoski, and the way that Kyle Glogoski is just like working his way up steadily through the pipeline, through the, that's exactly what we're talking about in the Patreon pre-podcast about pipelines and progressions and pathways and whatnot. He's the, you know, baseball has a very unique one, and he is just steadily stepping through everything nice and comfortably, and definitely a name to watch for the future.
Big him up. My deep in the mangroves is just a bit of a situation with City Kickboxing. One of their fighters at City Kickboxing, Fo Vake, passed away after seemingly being attacked in Auckland. It was already like a lull for City Kickboxing. They're already in a quiet period that we had talked about before. There is a upcoming bout, Adesanya versus Marvin Vettori, a rematch of a previous fight that Adesanya won prior to that. And that same event, you've got Brad Riddell fighting Drew Dober. So Brad Riddell, he was meant to fight Gregor Gillespie earlier this year, and that fight got cancelled due to COVID stuff. So it's been it's been better than it has this week for City Kickboxing, but Adesanya had a loss to Jan Błachowicz. Brad Riddell's fight got scratched, and I think Carlos Ulberg lost his UFC debut. So there has been a bit of a dip. Junior Farr lost his fight against Joseph Parker. Junior Farr has started up a YouTube channel, so there's vlogs from Junior Farr as well. Bit of a down period for City Kickboxing. They've been building back up for this UFC event at UFC 263, which is June 13th, New Zealand time, so that's coming up soon. So they've been preparing for that card, and then one of their fighters, Fo Vake, was killed. So there's been a couple deaths out of the City Kickboxing group over the years, so I'm sure they will rally together, and it kind of sets up the UFC 263 on the June 13th as a, you know, it'll be a pretty emotional event for the City Kickboxing coaching staff, Adesanya and Brad Riddell as well, and everyone at City Kickboxing. So been a bit stink buzz, but they still have fights coming up, and if there's anything we've known, come to know about City Kickboxing, they will do their teammate proud. What do we have as far as questions go, Wildcard? You've got two, I've got one, so you can take the first one here. What do you got?
Well, let's throw back to some Phoenix stuff, the way we started the podcast, because we recorded a Phoenix special for the longer podcast on, what was it, you know, Thursday or whatever it was last week. And during that episode, you mentioned how much you'd enjoyed watching Clayton Lewis play and rise of him. We talked a fair bit about Clayton Lewis's career as it is. He had just re-signed at that point. And then Clayton Lewis goes and scores the opening goal for the Phoenix against Western United. So you've obviously put a significant sort of like Nostradamus blessing upon him. I'm asking you now, who are you going to... who are you going to take the magic wand out and bless for the I don't know if we're saying rest of the season or just the next game, or just who's going to be the next recipient from the Phoenix squad of this mystical blessing.
Well, it's a bit rude of you to assume that I'm going to give it to someone else. Like, I'm here for Clayton Lewis.
The more the merrier.
I'm only, it's all about Clayton Lewis. I'm not going to share that juju with someone else. Like, it's all about Clayton Lewis. He's the guy. And I'm doubling down on Clayton Lewis. I'm not giving it anywhere else. Like, Clayton Lewis is the most important Wellington Phoenix player. He had 3 interceptions versus Western United. The most interceptions of any Wellington Phoenix player. He had a goal as well on top of that. He is the guy. So I'm not sure what you're trying to get at here as far as, like, giving it to Piscopo or fucking Stephen Taylor. No, it's always Clayton Lewis. He's the guy. Beautiful strike into the body of the Western United defender. Well placed. He was everywhere. Tireless in the midfield. Shout out Clayton Lewis.
Yeah, Ben Wayne was the guy I was hoping you were going to say. But you know what? I hadn't considered the point that if you gave it to someone else, that might be taking it away from Lewis. I was sort of assuming that the blessing was something permanent. But, you know, fair play. Under those circumstances, you get to make the rules of your blessings, not me. So I'll cede this one to yourself there. I accept what you're saying. And yes, let's get Clayton Lewis scoring some more goals for the last 3 games.
Part of it is I want him to back it up. So I want to extend my blessing to, like, for him to help lead the Wellington Phoenix throughout this playoff push. I'm not looking for a one-game wonder. I'm a long-term joker. So when I was jumping on board the Clayton Lewis train, that was for the next 3 games at least. So I'll continue my blessings to Clayton Lewis. We have NBA playoffs have started wildcard, and I want you to look into your little crystal ball there. How is this going to end up for Sean Marks and the Brooklyn Nets? Do you see it imploding? Do you see the Brooklyn Nets winning it all and Sean Marks is the hero? How do you, Sean Marks, for those who don't know, Kiwi, tall black, boss man of the Brooklyn Nets. He's the guy who put everyone in their place. Like literally, as opposed to figuratively putting people in their place, because he's not going to do that to Kevin Durant or Kyrie Irving or James Harden. But how do you see it ending up for the Brooklyn Nets and Sean Marks? What's your vibe there?
Well, for Sean Marks, I might do this week. I was thinking of writing an article just explaining why he is going to win the Executive of the Year, which I'm very much on board with that happening. Not normally someone who cares that much about individual awards within team sport, but it's always nice to recognize people who do good things. And I think Marks, as is always the case with Executive of the Year, which is one of the friskiest of all of the awards, because, like, MVP, at least you can say best player over the course of the season. It's quite a, like, it's the definition of most valuable gets tricky sometimes, but it's at least a, like, defined period of time. General managership, a lot of doing well within one season depends on what you did in previous seasons. So I think Marks has been someone who has been sort of, like, doing a lot of good things to get himself a good name within the league over many years in this role. This was the year when that got to pay off in a whole bunch of flashy, dramatic, big name, the Harden trade, and getting some of those, like, and the Harden trade looks better and better by the day, like, especially when you look at how absolutely terrible the Houston Rockets ended up on the other side of that. And to be fair to Marks, like, he might not be a physically put guys in their place type of leader, but he's definitely done it to some of his, like, definitely done it to some of his rival general managers, like the poison pill restricted free agent contracts from the start of his career, and some of the deals he's done. He tends to come off better in them. I think he's probably got a reputation for that as well at this point. But yeah, the big flashy moves came this year, and this is the year when everything gets to click, and they're actually going to have a playoff run. So I think that's how I see it happening for Sean Marks. As to the Brooklyn Nets, I I think they'll do pretty well. I don't see them necessarily imploding early. They got the Celtics in the first round. They already won the first game. Celtics, this is without Jaylen Brown, and they sort of limped into the play-in situation. They did pretty well once they got there, but, like, it's not the best Celtics team we've seen for a few years, and I think the Nets are just going to be too strong for them. They're just going to have too much relentless scoring, and the Celtics are going to, like Jason Tatum scoring 50 points a night or something like that. I just don't see them keeping up in that one. And then when they go through there, it's Miami or Milwaukee. That's a tricky tie. It's supposed to be once you get to the second round of playoffs, it's not supposed to be anything that comes easy. Brooklyn are a little bit of an unknown quantity because we haven't seen enough of them with all three of their star players, with Harden, Irving, and Durant all available. So that does make things, it makes them a little bit of an unknown. It makes them a little bit of a dark horse in a weird way for a team that's like overwhelmingly stacked. But I suspect they'll, like, I don't look at those teams and think Brooklyn can't beat them. I think the only team they're going to have genuine trouble with is Philadelphia, which would be first versus second seed, which means we won't get that till the conference finals. And I think if they make the conference finals in their first proper year, even if they do drop out, I don't think you can call it a failure. I think people will, because there's this idea that their championship will bust. But, like, I don't think they're busted unless they fall short of, like, if they get to the conference finals, I think that can be accepted as a like, still an okay season, didn't achieve their goals, but, you know, they're close, they're in contention. You don't win it every year just because you're the best team, sort of thing. That's not how sports work. There's a lot of elements of luck and risk and stuff that's out of your control that comes into the matter. And I'm not going to bet on anything beyond that, but I think they'll get to the conference finals. And once you get to that point, like, you're in the mix, and that's all you can ask for.
I think it's just the life objective should just look like, I just want to stay in the mix. Just stay in the mix. It's all, I just want to be in the mix. Like, it's a beautiful, beautiful thing. What is your second question to throw back? Hopefully you stay in the mix there.
Yeah, let's keep it in the mix. And there's a lot to be said for that, just quietly. Like, there's the teams that sort of finish around, I think the Toronto Raptors were a good example of a team that stayed in the mix, and then all of a sudden they could trade for old mate, what's his name, Kawhi Leonard one day, and then that just took them over the top to the West suddenly in the season where, because they were in the mix, they were like in that, they were in a position to pounce at the time when the Warriors had a bunch of injuries, and they won a championship for it. Like, that's one very good way to win, is just to never bottom out and just to stay slightly in contention, and then one day two big things go your way, or one season two big things go your way, your biggest rival for the title has a couple injuries, and then, like, you manage to scoop up an all-NBA talent player in the trade deadline. Sweet ass. That's how you win stuff. Wasn't trade deadline, was it? But still. My question for you here is, it's about time we put some cricket into this podcast. And next Wednesday night, I believe it is, the Black Caps begin the first test match against England. Obviously, the Test Championship final is the major focus of this tour, but there are two tests to get through against England first. Few different ways it could go, whether they use it as preparation or whether there's an opportunity for some of the younger guys or whatever, or will there be some rotation? I don't know. But what I'm going to ask you is, what are you most hoping to see out of that series, specifically against England? Like, Test Championship final to the side, we know what we're hoping to get out of that one. What are you hoping to What are you hoping to see from the Black Caps against England?
Keyword being hoping.
Certainly.
I'm hoping to see Kyle Jamieson bowl at some point. I don't know what their, like, scheduling is with the IPL stuff and when they'll be available. The offshoot of that is whoever gets an opportunity in the whole team, like batting and bowling, like batsmen and bowlers put together, I think there will be a, like, not a full-strength first 11 Black Caps team for that first test, and that's going to present opportunities. So that's interesting. So hopefully, I'm hoping that maybe something interesting happens there. I don't. You seem to think that Devin Conway is a gun starter for that opening job, so that will be interesting. I'm not hoping for that, because then you're right. So That's just not as cool. And I would like to see Tom Blundell opening. But ultimately, across the two tests, I just want to see Kyle Jamieson bowl in England with the Duke ball. Can he maintain this freakish run that he's on? That's what I'm kind of most curious and hoping to see.
The longer he maintains it, the more historic that gets too. Because what is he after, like, 6 test matches or something, averaging about 13 or something crazy like that? Like, if he expands that into, like, 10 test matches or whatever, we're getting into some, like, you remember when Michael Hussey first started playing test cricket and he was batting at like a Don Bradman average for like the first, probably with him, it was probably like 30 test matches or whatever until he faded down to something, I think, in that like high 50 range or whatever. Like, Kyle Jamieson is sort of doing the bowling equivalent of that, but it's just too small of a sample size so far to claim it yet.
I think you got to go across sports for that comparison. You got to go Reece Walsh. Like, Reece Walsh, Kyle Jamieson, how effective they have been early in their careers against, you know, at the highest level, I think is very similar. And then you say what you said about Kyle Jamieson. If you stretch that out for Reece Walsh, and you're suddenly you're looking at him replicating what he's doing now for 10 more games, 15 more games, then you're looking at one of the hottest patches of Warriors form that we've ever dealt with, and maybe that helps the Warriors out. So I think very similar between Reece Walsh and Kyle Jamieson there. Any further?
Yeah, Kyle Jamieson, 6 test matches, 36 wickets, 13.3 average. So I actually guessed that right. I was going off the top of my head, but I guess I've looked at those numbers enough over the last few months to have them pretty well imprinted in my brain, apparently.
Well, just while we're chucking out funny cricket statistics, I have been following Netherlands cricket. They played against Scotland. Now they're playing against Ireland soon. They have Max O'Dowd and Logan van Beek. Max O'Dowd's from Auckland. Logan van Beek, Wellington Firebirds player. Max O'Dowd, Dutch international, ODI record of 4 games, 235 runs, average of 78.3. And 3 half centuries in his 4 innings. So very Reece Walsh-esque, Kyle Jamieson-esque for Max O'Dowd with the Dutch international team. What has been perking up your musical antenna there, Wildcard?
Quite a few things, because obviously we didn't do the jams portion of the thing last week. So I've had a couple of weeks to be absorbing new tunes. I will admit I've probably more than anything else been listening to Birthday Boy Bob over the last couple of weeks over that course of time. But we'll check out a couple of new things as well. Garcia Peoples did one of them Relic Session things, where like a live show was done for live stream and then released as well in audio form, and it's just excellent. Like, that's one of the primary modern jam bands right there, Garcia Peoples. So anything they do, I'm definitely going to be involved in some listening capacity. Also, album out by a band called Grave Flowers Bongo Band, which I believe a Ty Segall sort of like San Francisco garage rocky type of acolytes. I think Ty might have even produced this record for them. I'm not 100% certain, but you get exactly what you expect from that. Like, I think there's I'd have to listen to it again to see. The bongos weren't as prominent as the name suggests that they would be. More of just like another crunchy garage band, which is very much up my alley. And then also bringing it back to local shores. There's an album by a fella called Mata TK, who the album's been put out on Tom Scott's record label, and it's had a little bit of promotion and stuff behind it in New Zealand musical circles. He seems to be one of those dudes, Mata TK, who like other musicians just adore him. His new album is called, where are we here? Bad Meditation. And it's not 100 miles away from the type of sound that Troy Kingi was doing on his most recent album, where, like, I guess the difference is Troy Kingi was doing sort of like Curtis Mayfield type of funky 70s soul and and Mata TK has kind of taken it into space a little bit more, a little more sort of psychedelic soul. There's a few different touchstones you could check out there, but there was definitely a brief period there in like Marvin Gaye's career where he was doing this type of stuff, and it's an excellent album. I want to listen to it a couple more times as well. Definitely be chucking that one up on the album's jukebox next week or whenever we get around to that. But yeah, that's an excellent one. That's on Bandcamp for anyone who wants to listen as well.
Speaking of Bandcamp, there's a new rapper Wiki has a project on Bandcamp as well. Name is something about telephone booths, if I remember off the top of my head. But the big one has been J. Cole's album, which is pretty cool. It's always interesting to anytime like I go to listen to J. Cole, I'm like interested, what has he been thinking about? What has he been processing and working through as an artist in these modern times? And then you kinda, I don't know, I realize that I'm kinda into seeing where they are at as well, as opposed to like, because everyone, especially hip-hop is now pop music, so everyone is doing hip-hop in their own different ways. So the conversation around like who's the best rapper, I think, is basically null and void now. Like everyone just raps differently, so there's no real, you can't really have a discussion about who is the best, because it's way more subjective now than I think it used to, just because now hip-hop has expanded to encompass all sorts of different shit. So like, I'm not here to say J. Cole's the best rapper, I just enjoy the stories that he's telling and how sounds pretty cool, doesn't sound outdated. There's always like new interesting sounds that he's offering as well. Some of the beats slap, some of them are quite introspective, so it's a good combination, versatile. But he's obviously an interesting dude, and anytime you get that Kendrick Lamar, J. Cole type of artist, you're like, what have they been processing? Because their creativity, again, wrapping it all up full circle here, the creation is just a reflection of what you have been processing internally. It's the expression of that through your creation. Wow.
There we go.
Pick it up, J. Cole. Good project. Also enjoy that Wiki project as well. It's very short and sharp, poetry based. There's a lot of stuff happening. There's a lot of stuff brewing just with releases. And I actually think, like, to finish here, Wildcard, I think there's going to be a wave of a lot of creative stuff coming out as we emerge from the pandemic. I think a lot of artists would have everyone had to slow down, but then I think the artists would have been a lot more deliberate in how they want to share their work coming out of this. And I believe now we're reaching a stage where now's the time that it's going to be released. Like, they've gone through the creative process, they've fine-tuned it, they've sharpened it up, and I think a lot of the big, most creative, most avant-garde type of artists are going to come out and release their stuff over the next month or so.
Yeah, it stacks up. I mean, if like, I've heard it go both ways with people I've just heard talking about this, like the creative processes during lockdown on like podcasts and whatever, where some people just like, without the vibrant life leading aspect of what they do, like not being out on the road and not like going and meeting people and finding inspiration, like some people have found it really hard. But then I think a lot of other people do their best work in isolation, and this is like a year-long writer's retreat. So definitely those types of folks who have now had a few months as well to actually like get into a studio since things eased up a little bit, definitely, yeah, with you on that one, that there's going to be like, I'm going to say over the entire rest of the year, basically, and there will be quite a few of these sort of like pandemic projects popping up, and people who've been very busy and are ready to like unleash everything all of a sudden.
Let it go, unleash, create, kia kaha, stay beautiful. We'll be back in a couple of days with another episode of the Niche Cast. Cheer, cheer.